good afternoon, everyone. Let me just start with summarizing what we had discussed in the previous weekend. Dr. Suhas had taken us through whether adult ADHD was a diagnostic entity. So we now know that it is something that is reliably diagnosed, predicts future outcome, and the patterns of genetic transmission, the abnormalities that turn up in brain imaging, the neurocognitive and the biological findings are similar to those of children, and we're seeing it on a continuum with children with ADHD. So let's begin with a case vignette, just to show you how it can be different from manifestations in children, how adult ADHD manifests. So this is a 38-year-old male computer engineer. He is frequently angry, and this is a strain on his professional and personal relationships. Retrospectively, he's performed not so well in school, which has been less than his intellectual ability, and was found to be quite inattentive. And his boss reports that he's not engaging adequately with his team and not completing tasks in an organized or timely way. But he denies any depression or periods of abnormal mood lasting for longer than a few hours, and experiences intense rage and anger in response to frustrations in a typical day. So for example, when he's interrupted and he's doing something, is involved in something and he's interrupted, or if any last minute changes are made, these are very difficult for him to cope and will have a lot of reactions. At home, he's known to have a short fuse, and the atmosphere has gotten quite problematic, especially in the context of parenting, and both his wife and children are quite affected by this. This, I think, shows us a little more about how something like adult ADHD can manifest, where there is no obvious hyperactivity. I thought we would run everyone by quickly the diagnostic criteria. So it's called hyperkinetic disorders in ICD-10. I've not put up those criteria because, the DSM-5 does a good job in covering the criteria. It's a persistent pattern of inattention and or hyperactivity impulsivity that interferes with functioning, and interferes with functioning here needs to be highlighted as characterized by either inattention or hyperactivity. So in inattention, for persons older than 17 or older, they need 5 or more of the next set of symptoms for at least 6 months to a degree that is inconsistent with their developmental level and then negatively impacts various domains of their functioning. So there is poor attention to detail, careless mistakes, sustenance of attention is a problem, not listening when spoken to directly, not following through, so failure to complete tasks, difficulty in organizing. So one thing where starkly comes out is very poor time management, failure to meet deadlines. They're reluctant to engage in anything that requires a long period of mental effort. So working on lengthy papers, preparing reports is all quite difficult for them. They lose things very easily, easily distracted by extraneous stimuli. So in adults, we've also seen that they may have unrelated thoughts, and they find it difficult to remember to call you back, remember to keep appointments. The second set is for hyperactivity and impulsivity. They fidget and squirm. This is so you'll see another hyperactivity element. Does a lot of it is more relevant for children. They leave the seat in situations where remaining seated is expected. They're feeling restless, unable to engage in leisure activities quietly, on the go as if driven by a motor, talk excessively, blurt out an answer before a question is completed, difficulty waiting turn, and they interrupt and intrude. And the DSM-5 clearly tells us that the restless bit, the interruption and intrusion, these adults can be quite intruding and can be understood to be quite deficient in understanding the social context. And then what is interesting is in the DSM-5, they categorically say that these symptoms must be present before age 12. So it is very important in an adult ADHD to first establish that there has been a childhood presence of symptoms. One cannot exist, the adult ADHD cannot exist in the absence of that in two or more settings. And they interfere with various domains of functioning and not exclusively in the course of a mental disorder. And it's also gone into telling us about some specifiers. I thought what was also important to discuss was the UTA criteria and how it is different from the DSM-5. So the DSM-5 has two broad categories of hyperactivity and inattention. The Utah criteria talks about a childhood history, which is again essential. But the adult symptoms of hyperactivity and poor concentration is the first symptom, followed by two of the following. If you see these are quite different from what the DSM-5 has suggested. Affective lability, hot temper, inability to complete tasks, yes, disorganization, stress intolerance, and impulsivity. So there seem to be certain affective symptoms which seem to have been highlighted in this criteria. What is also different in the Utah criteria is that they say that ADHD cannot actually be diagnosed with a coexisting major depression, psychosis, or a personality disorder. And there's been quite a bit of debate on this. Moving on to the epidemiology. The prevalence is 3.4%, and it's higher in the higher income countries. And I think there is an issue of overdiagnosis, which we can talk about if time permits. So it moves on from childhood to adulthood in 60 to 70% of the cases. And the ratio is smaller. The gender ratio in adults is smaller. It's 1.6 is to 1. Females often present with the key symptom of inattention. They've also found that certain groups are more vulnerable. So 40% of imprisoned men have ADHD. And psychiatric outpatient clinics seem to have a preponderance. This table sort of throws light on the comorbidities that they can have. So the percentages actually reflect comorbidities. A lot of these disorders seem to have some symptoms that are shared with ADHD. So for instance, if one is very depressed, then there is definitely issues with concentration and attention, difficulty with task completion, but you may not get a persistent pervasive pattern of low mood, anhedonia, and sleep and appetite disturbances. It's gotten a very, very high comorbidity with generalized anxiety disorder. The difficulty concentrating is extremely marked in both. However, these anxiety symptoms and the worry symptoms are not understood to be key to ADHD. In this particular study, with substance use disorders, we've understood this to have a 15% comorbidity, with the difficulty in attention, the mood lability, all being components that are shared. But of course, the direct dependence syndrome symptoms of substance use are not shared in ADHD. But a study from our center, and I'll just go into that, has shown that the rates might be a little higher. And in personality disorders, we definitely see that oppositional, defiant, antisocial personality have a high rate of comorbidity with ADHD. So like I was saying, in our center, there is a study with 240 patients. This study is in press, of which, depending on whether we've taken a very stringent criteria or a broader criteria, the range of those who were likely to have ADHD was 21.7 to about 56% people. So much higher prevalence in our Center for Addiction Medicine here than previously documented. So since this is on diagnosis, I think we should talk about who should be screened. And substance use disorders, persons presenting with these, especially those with an early onset, should definitely be screened. Personality disorders, one should be cautious of picking up features of low frustration tolerance, inattention, difficulty in persisting as being features of an adult ADHD. Those which have a history of academic failures, job losses, and where there is a patient who presents with a psychiatric disorder but has a family history of ADHD, again, one must be cautious. And now, what should be assessed? So yes, inattention. And attention can have various components, sustaining attention, focusing on a task, and how distractible the person is. Hyperactivity, which is usually manifest in a sense of internal restlessness in the patient. Impulsivity. Now, there are various models for impulsivity. There are various types of impulsivity. I've actually picked up two models just to show us. You know, when we say impulsive, we don't only mean blurt out or complete other people's sentences. So this is a 1975 model, which has spoken about four components in impulsivity, which is how much control you have to inhibit your responses, how long, how quickly you come to a decision, whether you can persist at a task, and what is the extent of sensation novelty seeking. And this is a slightly more recent model, which has divided impulsivity into motor, cognitive, and non-planning. Motor would mean, again, quickly taking on, jumping to doing a task. Cognitive is how quickly one takes a decision. So again, the internal representation of the motor task. And non-planning is your inability to plan in a stepwise manner and just jump to the next step. Another important thing which is often overlooked in adult ADHD is deficits in emotional regulation. I'll come to this because there is a significant amount of work now, and they've drawn some parallels between a borderline personality structure and an ADHD. So we should probably look at emotional regulation a little more detailed. We've already discussed timekeeping, planning. You'll also see that the impairment is quite marked in their social functioning. And of course, we should assess symptoms of childhood ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder, and conduct disorder. So like I was saying, emotional dysregulation, I thought we would, this is something a lot of us don't know about, so I thought this was quite relevant. DESR is deficient emotional self-regulation. What it means is they are unable to regulate their physiological arousal. They are unable to inhibit their behavior, which is in response to these emotions. They have a problem taking their attention away and refocusing it into something different when they're experiencing these strong emotions. And fourth, the behavior itself, when emotionally activated, becomes quite disorganized. So how this manifests is that there is low frustration tolerance, quite a bit of impatience, quickness to anger, and which is quite concerning is that it can be confused very easily with a soft bipolar, a BPAD, or an emotionally unstable sort of disorder. So in this study, this is a 2011 study, they found that 60% of adults with ADHD had traits of DESR in comparison to 50% of the normal controls. And it does seem to represent a distinct familial subtype as well. So while we've spoken about how we should be cautious of all these things and we should be assessing all this, the reason why all this is relevant is because now it is understood to be occurring together and having specific phenotypic and genotypic material. The externalizing spectrum has a family history and early onset substance use that is subsequent or consequential to of early history of ADHD, conduct disorder, poor social functioning. All of this comes together. It forms a distinct phenotype with greater symptom severity, a longer course, and a greater difficulty with abstinence. We also know that it has a shared neurobiological genetic diastasis. Coming to assessment. Like we were discussing earlier, the assessment of adult ADHD is a little tricky and we need multiple sources of information. Just self-report cannot be the defining factor for us. It needs to be corroborated with information from primary caregivers, clinical interviews, documentation of childhood, which typically includes report cards and grading sheets from childhood, and when available, neuropsychological assessment. In adult ADHD, there is no gold standard, but what we do know is that it should not be exclusively based on information from the patient. They can have a very biased recall of their childhood events, and it should be obtained from significant others who've known the patient during childhood. This information from parents is also important because it tells us about what is the level of impairment and how significant are the current symptoms as well. But since we're speaking of clinical interviews, there's the CADID, which is the Cornell's Adult ADHD Diagnostic Interview for DSM-4. This has two parts, where the first part is a history and the second part is a diagnostic criteria interview. It's actually quite lengthy, but quite comprehensive in a way. The mini plus includes a separate model for ADHD. So the ADHD does not actually find mention in the mini or the skit. While the childhood versions of both these have assessments of childhood ADHD, adult ADHD only finds a column in the mini plus. And then there's the Dutch diagnostic interview for ADHD in adults. That's the DIVA, which picks up symptoms again, both in childhood and in adulthood. Rating scales. So according to diagnostic guidelines for adult ADHD, rating scales are of two types, one that tap on current symptoms and those that tap on the childhood longitudinal development of symptoms. And one, at least one scale tapping on current and one tapping on the longitudinal history is suggested in the diagnostic guideline. Of these, we have the BADS, which is the Brown ADD rating scale. It's quite a long scale, but it picks up on cognitive symptoms such as difficulty initiating and maintaining optimum arousal. These are the domains of the scale. Then is the CARS, which is Connor's Adult ADHD Rating Scale. There is a shorter version of this scale. And this too assesses not only inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity, but emotional lability and self-concept. It also correlates quite well with the Wender-Utah scale that we were mentioning earlier. And then something that was presented in the case presentation just a little while ago, the ADHD, Adult ADHD Self-Report Scale V1.1, which is the ASRS. This is a WHO scale. It's quite easy to use. So these were the scales for the current symptoms. Now, symptoms through development can be picked up quite well on the Wender-Utah scale. There is a shorter version, so you need not use a 61-item one. There is a 25-item version. And it's been validated quite widely. These ratings are retrospective. I'll quickly also show you this scale because it's quite interesting, the kind of questions there are. Rating scales have been understood to be useful in screening. So the ASRS we quite routinely use at NIMHANS to screen patients and see if they're likely to have adult ADHD. They're also useful as a pre and post, on the initiation of stimulants. If the post rating for the scale improves, we know that a lot of benefit has been achieved. But for diagnosis, they should not be used independently. So the ASRS we've already had a look at. I thought we should also just quickly have a look at the Wender-Utah scale and see that there are items such as moody, ups and downs, hot and short-tempered, as well as guilty feelings, regretful. So a lot of impetus has been given to affective symptoms. It's also a retrospective, all of this is retrospective, but a retrospective analysis of the child's academic performance in school. So I was overall a poor student, the last three items, trouble with mathematics, not achieving up to potential. So it was quite comprehensive as a retrospective interview. So after we've looked at scales, this is about neuropsychological assessment. Again, it's an important pre and post measure for the evaluation of an intervention. And usually in ADHD, we sort of focus on the frontal functions of attention and executive functions. So in assessment of attention, there is Connors has developed as well as there are several kinds of continued performance tests. These, if they're supposed to continue at a task and they're missing out on potential targets, that seems to show that they're unable to attend, and that's why they're making mistakes. I'll just quickly put this here because if you can see in the response inhibition, the last bullet, the continuous performance test commission errors, where they're hitting on something that is not a target, that shows that they're unable to inhibit their response. So continuous performance tests have been used quite widely to understand where the deficit in ADHD lies. So a lot of research studies are done using this test. There are several others, and we can go into a discussion of them, but that we can ask questions about, we shouldn't. Here at NIMHANS, we use the 2004 Mukundan's NIMHANS Neuropsych Battery, where we use digit cancellation, which is, again, a test of sustained attention, color trails, which incorporates both focused attention and set shifting, And of course, other executive functions are picked up via Wisconsin's set shifting test, fluency tests, planning. Response inhibition, again, is definitely impaired in ADHD, and these are the several tests for it. Neuropsych assessment, and what are the various things we can do. So as we're moving forward, there is a lot of talk about developing EEG, SPECT, biomarker kind of things for ADHD, adult ADHD diagnosis, including more specific neuropsychological batteries. However, the current research talks about a lot of doubts about the specificity and the sensitivity of this. So the positive and the negative predictive value of these tests of executive functioning, whether they can screen out correctly all the patients who have ADHD and are able to exclude those who definitely don't have, is actually not sufficiently high. And so in the diagnosis of adult ADHD, it is still the clinician's judgment and the interview which is the most important. The next slide was on the issue of overdiagnosis, and let's just not get into this. We've spoken enough about this. So we know that there has been a six-fold increase between 94 to 2009 in the psychiatrist's office, and an eight-fold increase amongst non-psychiatrists. And of course, the rates have also doubled in a five-year span in UK. So there's a lot of Western debate about why there is an overdiagnosis. And there are a couple of points that have been mentioned, including a flawed diagnostic criteria, which is much too broad, allows for much too overlap and comorbidity to play in. Failure to apply the criterion for childhood onset. So biased past recall, as well as not consulting with parents, not getting school records. Too much of reliance on these screening tools, which have a high probability of false positives. And of course, like Dr. Sharanya was mentioning, medicalization, the pharmaceutical companies being involved. So this is the issue of overdiagnosis. There's an article in 2011 by the author is Upadhyay et al., who's spoken about there still being the fact that adult ADHD is not being picked up adequately in substance use setups in India. So we are still probably not looking at this as seriously as we should be. And these are my references.